¿Qué tal? Muy buenos días. Mi nombre es José Manuel Martínez, consultor de servicios de TI aquí en Lowbre International. Le doy pues la más cordial bienvenida a este webinar con el tema tips para proteger su servidor AIX. La agenda para el día de hoy pues es acerca de nosotros, de Lowbre International, y vamos a ver el Webex titulado tips para proteger su servidor AIX. Acerca de nosotros, de Lowbre International, somos una empresa de consultoría de TI con más de 20 años de experiencia en Latinoamérica y Europa. Implementamos soluciones que apoyan las mejores prácticas como lo son ITIL, ISO 27002 y COVID. Bueno, nuestro modelo de negocios, perdón, es el siguiente. Siguiendo las mejores prácticas, creamos metodologías propias basadas en la experiencia. Y usando la tecnología, les ofrecemos a ustedes, nuestros clientes, pues servicios de consultoría, soluciones de software, actualización tecnológica, para ayudarlos a alcanzar pues los objetivos de negocio. Contamos con una metodología en la cual implementamos en cuatro fases cuando llevamos a cabo nuestros proyectos. Y la primera de ellas pues es el análisis, donde vamos a recopilar la información sobre la infraestructura, esa parte medular de sus sistemas y la parte del entorno de negocio, es decir, cómo trabajan ustedes actualmente. La siguiente fase, el modelo tecnológico, en esta toda la información del análisis que elaboramos, ese modelo tecnológico donde tomamos en cuenta todos sus procesos de negocio, la tecnología que utilizan y usando las mejores prácticas, las vamos a alinear a la estrategia corporativa y a los objetivos del negocio. La fase de implementación, donde vamos a realizarla a tres niveles, es decir, en la operativa, en la ejecutiva, vamos a tener igualmente la parte donde está operativamente y vamos a nosotros mostrar en la parte operativa donde casi todos se centran esos proyectos, pero también le vamos a dar esa parte ejecutiva y directiva, esa información que requieren, pues para que sepan qué está pasando cuando se tenga este proyecto y lo vamos a apoyar por medio de reportes y gráficas. Y la parte de validación, donde pues nuestro compromiso es llevar a cabo esa validación de resultados que se obtuvo en el uso de la tecnología y el apoyo que tuvieron al día a día. Igualmente, contamos con líneas de negocio. La primera de ellas es la seguridad de la información. Aquí contamos con aplicaciones que van a permitir tener un registro claro y preciso sobre quién accede a esa información, quién puede realizar cambios, cómo están los perfiles en el sistema. Vamos a poder monitorear las políticas de seguridad, entre otras cosas, aquí, así como definir quién puede entrar a realizar ciertos cambios, igual quién puede ejecutar ciertos comandos y la parte de envío de información de manera, perdón, encriptada con GoAnywhere. La siguiente es la de monitoreo de infraestructura y servicios de TI. Aquí vamos a apoyarlos a ustedes a conocer esa disponibilidad de los dispositivos de red. Vamos a poder obtener dashboard, pantallas que le van a informar sobre lo que sucede en sus dispositivos. Vamos a poder tener alarmas sobre algún comportamiento que sea anormal. Y vamos a poder realizar y dar seguimiento puntual para saber cómo van en tiempo real sus ventas, el estatus de sus inventarios. Y por la parte de Intermapper, vamos a poder saber cómo están los dispositivos, la disponibilidad de sus equipos, el uso de ancho de banda, quiénes son los usuarios que están consumiendo pues este recurso. La parte de control de cambios, aquí pues nuestra tecnología nos va a permitir dar ese seguimiento al ciclo de desarrollo de software para mejorar los controles de versiones, los cambios que se van a poder realizar, la forma de distribución pues en diferentes sistemas. Y es con ello vamos a poder reducir el tiempo empleando la liberación de algún cambio o igualmente en un nuevo módulo. La parte de performance and capacity planning, vamos a dar a conocer el desempeño de sus servidores, los servicios que tienen instalados en su negocio, vamos a poder igual ayudarlos a realizar esa proyección que les va a permitir saber en cuánto tiempo será necesario aumentar los recursos del servidor o incluso cuándo debiesen cambiarlo. Y la parte de automatización de tareas y procesos de TI, aquí vamos a poder ayudarles a administrar y automatizar esas tareas y procesos en múltiples plataformas, ayudado igualmente de dashboard y de diagramas de flujo, donde vamos a poder verificar qué es lo que ocurre en esta automatización. Con los más de 20 años de experiencia, pues aquí algunos de nuestros clientes. Y bueno, a lo largo de estos 20 años, pues hemos formado alianzas sólidas con empresas líderes en la industria que nos van a respaldar con ese software de vanguardia, y vamos a poder brindar a ustedes las mejores soluciones y servicios especializados. Y en esta ocasión tocó el turno a Health System, que bueno, Health System tiene más de 30 años en el mercado de TI, atiende a más de 10.000 clientes alrededor del mundo. Igual atiende a 350 de las 2.000 mejores empresas según Forbes. Y como invitado especial tenemos a Robin Tatam, que es director de tecnología de seguridad. Good morning, Robin. Please proceed with your presentation.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And good morning, everybody. Welcome to this session. I'm excited to be able to be here and talk to you, along with my colleague here, Mike, about AIX security. Just as a brief introduction, I am a IBMI power person primarily, but certainly through the explosion of AIX in the business marketplace, we are expanding our reach into that. And so excited to be bringing this content to you today. If you do have any questions, as Janine said, we'll be answering those at the end. But I am extremely happy to be sharing this podium today with Mike Davison, and I'm going to let Mike just say hi and introduce himself real quickly before we jump in to our primary content here.
Thanks, Robin. Hi, this is Mike here. I'm currently sat in the UK, in Peterborough, which is about 120k north of London, and I've worked for Health Systems for 3 years, and I've been in the IBM arena since I started work in the industry 30 years ago.
Don't look that old, Mike, but fantastic to have you. I appreciate it, and thanks for bringing the international contingent into the session here. Just as a very brief introduction from a health systems perspective, there's a pretty significant security investment here. We started in the automation business, but have a number of different product lines. Cybersecurity is definitely a primary focus for us, as it is, of course, for many of you. So between a comprehensive product portfolio and a suite of security services, we do address a lot of the power system needs, both on the IBMI side as well as the AIX side. As an organization, we're a member of the PCI Security Standards Council. We're also authorized by the National Association of State Boards of Accountancy to educate auditors on security. From the IBMI side, we also publish a very well-known and loved white paper, the State of IBMI Security Study, which is something we've been doing now since 2004. It gives us a lot of insight into power system servers and some of the mistakes and good things that people are doing on that platform. So we're going to be talking about AIX security tips, of course, and Mike and I are going to have some discussion around that. But I thought I would just start with a very simple analogy, just because when we talk about the task of ensuring good configuration, we really do have a pretty standard issue. So I thought I'd introduce you to Dave here. And Dave is a gentleman who owns a pretty significant size retail grocery store. Now, as you can imagine, and having been through many of these stores yourselves, you can imagine just how many thousands of items Dave and his team have to keep track of. Now, these items have to be checked constantly and repeatedly to ensure that they are certainly labeled correctly. We want to make sure they have the correct attributes associated with the reality of the item on the shelf versus the labeling. We have to ensure that all the items on the shelves are in the correct location or that there are no items missing that are unaccounted for. We have to check those items as well to ensure that they are within expiration, just as one of the attributes that we may check in this particular type of store. Of course, the big impact on revenue comes from the fact that we may have incorrect pricing. If we overprice things, we're going to have upset customers, and that's going to impact our revenue. If we underprice them, then obviously we're going to be bringing in less revenue just based on the difference between cost and price. Unfortunately, when it comes to checking up on these items and performing all these tasks, largely a manual process. We have to do an inventory review. If you've ever worked in the retail space, you'll know that this is often performed overnight, maybe over a couple of days or even a week span. It's largely a manual process because we have to go down and eyeball each item and check to make sure that we have the right quantity and that the items are labeled correctly. That task, as you can imagine, is extremely slow. And of course, being a manual process, is prone to human error. So what we end up doing is simply hoping and praying that everything that we're looking at is correctly configured, that we have the right attributes and price, that everything is in its correct location. Unfortunately, the reality is that that's not always the case. The idea of assuming or hoping and tends to end up with some form of an unhappy ending. When we talk about cybersecurity, it's a different story, but ultimately has the same ending. As we can see, even during 2016, we lost over 500 million records of data. Now, there's lots of different reasons for this. Certainly a lot of different actors that come into this particular game. But one of the interesting features I find is that when we take a look at breach sources, and this was a study that was published at the end of 2015, we see of all the elements that cause data breaches, arguably the fastest growing and most prevalent is attested to misconfiguration. So it's not necessarily an inherent weakness in the operating system. I think you all know the AIXOS can be extremely securable, just as the other power system OS can, but if we don't configure it correctly, it leaves us vulnerable to attack. Now with that, I'm going to hand it to Mike. We're going to talk a little bit about the initial history of the naming of AIX, if you're kind of new to that platform, and then we're going to talk through the 10 tips that we would like to introduce that will hopefully give you a good handle on ensuring that you have the correct configuration of your AIX servers. And then when we're done with that, we'll give you a way to perhaps automate that, simplify that task so that you can ensure that that configuration is always maintained. All right, Mike, talk to us about AIX. Give me some information about where this came from.
Thanks, Robin. AIX is a proprietary operating system from IBM. It was born in 1986 from Unix System 5, which came from the AT&T labs, and BSD Unix out of Berkeley. Unlike the Power OS IBM i, which we're all familiar with and love, it is not an object-oriented operating system, and it has a hierarchical file system, much like the IFS in the IBM i. So looking at some of the steps we can take to get our machines security compliance, we're going to look at removing unnecessary services, secure those operational services, identify our network interfaces, set our network options, secure the front door, we're going to tighten up our user accounts, lock down root, set a strong password policy, set limits, and monitor all of the above and some after that. So let's take a look at the first item on our list, removing unnecessary services. The system file etc init tab is used to decide which services are started on boot. And we should remove these services or stop these services from running because they have known vulnerabilities. What you do is make a backup copy of your init tab first, make the changes to it, and then reboot your system. And like I said, a number of these services that are running are legacy services. They might not be running on your machine, but how do you know that they've not been changed in init tab so the next time it boots, they're going to start up exposing your system? The system file etc/inetd.conf, the configuration file for all the internet daemon services. And what we should do with these services that we see on the screen here is point them out by placing a hash in position one of the attribute within the file so that they don't start when the inetd daemon starts. And a number of these have been identified over the years since the initial releases of the operating system and going back as far as AIX 4.3 that these services have security vulnerabilities, and that has been acknowledged by IBM themselves. Yet you'll still find these on your systems today, your 6.1, your 6.2, your 7.1 systems, and they could be started. Now, most people would like to think that these are all secure and they're switched off, and that might be the case. But how do you know that your configuration file hasn't been changed either accidentally or deliberately, and one of these services could possibly be started? But naturally, on our AIX server, we're going to be running a number of operational services. And we may want to run our AIX server as a DNS server. We need to make sure then that we secure it correctly. And IBM do a nice red book on that about securing DNS and AIX. However, we don't need to be running DNS daemon or DNS service if we are only doing hostname resolution, a common misconception. If we only want hostname resolution on that particular server, we only need to configure the system file resolve.conf. If we're presenting NFS shares to our network, then always double check them and make sure that you lock them down and make them read-only if possible. We don't want to be exposing our disk data to a read-write mount. Again, IBM's Red Book tells you all about that. SMTP, so if we're sending mail from the server or we're using it as an inbound or outbound mail server, we should restrict, verify, and extend commands, which will reveal information to attacker connecting to the SMT port, typically port 25. If we're using SNMP, change the community string to something that's hard to get, other than public or community, which are default ones and are commonly used. SNMP for AIX comes in three versions, V1, V2, V3. V3 offering enhanced security with secure user credentials, plus it's encrypted. And version 2 is the same as version 3, except it's not encrypted. So ideally, we want to be using V3. I'll say this quite simply. Don't TFTP. There are no credentials and there are no authentication. Also, FTP, it doesn't use encrypted communications, so your passwords are clearly visible by a network sniffer. So we'd always want to be using SFTP. If we're doing that, make sure we configure our FTP users and our FTP access.ctl file. Access to the system utilities cron and app for scheduling. Always lock them down using the cron.allow file, which then you put in the people who you want to be able to use it, as opposed to denying everybody else. The thing with the deny file is if you add new users to your system, you have to add them to the deny file. So it's a lot easier to just say only allow these people or this group.
Mike, on the NFS side, certainly I think viruses and malware have kind of bubbled up to the surface of what a lot of people are dealing with and concerned about. I know across the Power System server, the discussion of viruses and malware is a little bit, I think, controversial just because traditionally, we've kind of ducked out of what I think the Windows side of the house has to deal with. But presumably, if we do have too many shares out there, or the shares that are unnecessary, that's a great avenue for somebody to introduce potentially malicious code, even if it is actually resident on the remote device, and perhaps encrypting files within the AIX environment.
And that's absolutely right, Robin. Just like the IBM IFS, a read-write network file share could very easily host a Windows virus. It wouldn't necessarily infect an IBM AIX machine, being a different architecture. But if that share is being used around your network, it could very easily assist to propagate that virus around your corporate network. And that's, of course, where something like StandGuard antivirus for AIX and the IBM I would come in really handy. So identifying our network interfaces, we might think that, oh, well, I know what my interfaces are, but systems residing in power frames often have multiple network interfaces, and it might be that you've inherited a system or you've come new into a job, and you want to understand, or you should know, how many interfaces are A, defined and available to your system, and B, which ones are active, because they are all your entrances into that machine. Short of going to the HMC console in your computer room, this is the only other avenue in. So you should know what you've got defined, what's available, and what is active on your network. Alongside that, network options will control how TCP, UDP, and ICMP protocols behave on your machine. And we should use the NO command for network options to configure these settings, which I'm not going to go into huge amounts of detail, but again, there's an IBM Red Book that helps you understand the reason why we set these. For example, clean partial comms set to 1 will clear incomplete three-way connections and prevent a thin denial of service attack on your machine. Setting broadcast ping to 0 is going to protect against SMURF ICMP attacks. So there's a number of settings there that we should make sure that they are set and that they are consistently left like this and not changed. The login.config file controls the front door access when using TelnetD. It should be one of the first things to tighten down. But wait, I hear you say, who uses TelnetD these days? It's not secure. Well, that's absolutely right. We should all be using SSH. However, TelnetD is still available on your system. It's still available to be started. And if the Telnet daemon is either accidentally or maliciously started, if we don't set these settings to a reasonable level, it can give an attacker who's maybe already got into the system to make it easier for himself to get in. So we should set things like the login disabled, the failed number of attempts before a port is locked, the number of seconds for attempts before we lock the port, and the number of minutes before it's re-enabled. Similarly, for SSH, we should set the same things in the SSHD config. Define the login prompt when we access the system, the maximum number of attempts to log in through SSH, the maximum number of simultaneous connections. Now, a lot of these, that, for example, permit empty passwords, no, ignore our host, yes, host-based authentication, no, are all defaults with SSH. You might think, well, why do I need to set these? Well, actually, you don't. But you do need to check that they haven't been set to something else, either by misconfiguration or by somebody changing the file. It's always a good idea to keep your eye on that. ETC NOTD, message of the day, defines the message of the day. And it would be sensible to set it something along the lines of the following warning to all computer users. We should tighten up our user accounts. The following accounts are defined automatically on the system, things like guest, UUCP, LPD. They're all known accounts because they're predefined. It's well known that they're out there in the world. And an attacker could try a brute force attack with any of these accounts. So we need to lock them from being able to be used. And also locking the following group accounts. And then there's the IBM Redbook publication, SG245971, which gives more information on that and everything I've spoken about previously. Now, importantly as well, we all know root is our power user. We should disable remote and normal login. We should be logging in using our normal account, MikeD, for example, and SUing up to root. I see so many systems or so many companies in my job where I provide web support and the customer logs on using the root account. I point this out to them and they say, well, it's just too much effort to have an individual account. I'm the administrator, so it's not a problem. Wrong way to do things, folks. Okay? Review who can SU to root. I recently did a work for a company in Holland and they had the ability for every user on the system to attempt to SU to root. Then all it would need was be somebody sitting there SUing to root all the time. Let's just close that door and say, no, only our admins can SU to root and limit that SU capability to just a group of admins.
Rather than challenging the IBMI world to Mike, where all object special authority, which is our
Absolutely, Robin. Set a strong root password if necessary. If it's too difficult to remember, stick it in a password safe. That's what I do.
Don't put it on a post-it note.
Don't put it on a post-it note on the keyboard, no. And if you do need to give out privileged authority, then the well-known known and loved Sudo is available, and it comes shipped with IBM AAX now as well if you need to give out privileged authority. So we should establish a strong password policy as well. How many of you, the customers listening in today, have a strong password policy set? Don't know, but maybe we should go and have a look. We all used to changing our passwords in the Microsoft Windows world. That day of the month comes along, oh no, it's password change day again. Well, we need to do the same thing on AIX, and we should set things like the minimum age of our password, expired password change limit, number of character repetitions. We don't want a password that's AAABBB, for example. Minimum number of alpha characters, minimum number of unique characters, that all of these settings are available for you to configure in the etc security user file.
We have some recommendations here, obviously on the slide, but from a best practices perspective, of course, what you should be doing is determining your settings, documenting them in a security policy, and then ensuring that your system is adhering to that. So it's certainly very important to set them initially, but you don't want to assume they stay that way. You want to make sure that they're being checked against your own internal best practices.
That's absolutely right, Robin. So limits aren't strictly a security issue. However, I have included them here because with poorly set limits and a box that is logged on by lots of users, then we could cause problems for our machine's performance. So what we want to do is ensure that the etc security limits file, which defines the resource limits for users, should be set to sensible values for your environment. Now, a soft limit is a value that a user or application can change on the fly up to the maximum of the hard limit. And then we also have the hard limits, which is just that, a maximum value that the parameter can be set to. So what we don't want is one particular user consuming too much CPU or core time on our machine or getting too much memory. And now, every customer is different, every box is different, and the end use of the box is different. So it's up to you to set limits that are sensible for your systems. And finally, and probably the most important part, we've done all that hard work, we've gone through all of our settings, set them to reasonable standards or to regulatory requirement standards, we need to continually monitor. It's no good just logging on once a month and checking it. That would be a difficult process if you had 30, 40, 50, 100 maybe machines. But monitor your configuration files. Once you've configured your machine, once set up, they shouldn't change. Monitor your user group and password files for inconsistencies. Monitor for failed logins, repeated attempts to get to breach the system. Monitor who is using sudo and what they're doing. Monitor who is using su. Monitor your system directory's permissions. Regularly seek out the files that have no owners or groups. Seek out unauthorized rhost and netrc files. And we should also regularly seek out setuid or setgid programs that are owned by root, daemon, and bin, and check them against the known list of programs that are set by IBM. And that pretty much sums it up, Robin. What do you think about that?
I absolutely agree. And you know, the big message that I think is applicable to everybody, and this is not a platform statement, but the fact that security and both compliance are not set and forget, right? This becomes a lifestyle. Establishing the correct configuration is certainly the first piece of the puzzle, but that ongoing review, I think, is something that many of us are challenged with. It's a little bit different from most other projects. I think for many of us, whether it's from development or engineering, we set a goal, we establish the parameters of that project, we work to the completion of the project, and then we move on to the next project. But it's a little bit of a change of mindset here with security and compliance, because this is an evolutionary thing. The threats continue to evolve, and therefore our response to them has to continue. not somebody actually breaking the existing configuration. It's simply exploiting the lack thereof or a misconfigured item. And again, that is not an AIX statement. It's not even a power server statement. It's really just more of a common sense statement. But anytime we have something where that checking has to be done manually, Mike, as you said, the customer has 10, 20, 30, 40 machines, and they have to check all these settings across that, surely this is going to be a full-time job. What do we talk to with our customers when it comes to establishing automation of this process so that we don't have to do it ourselves? Can the server do that?
Yeah, Robin, it can, because we can use PolicyMinder for AIX. Any good sysadmin out there, and I've been one, I've been an AIX, an IBMI, and a mainframe sysadmin for many years, and I'd always write little scripts to check things on my machines and get them running across the network and gathering all that information for me. And any good sysadmin worth their salt will be doing that already. But regulatory requirements these days are asking for computer-generated, machine-generated reports that cannot be tampered with. And that, I think, is where PolicyMinder comes in for people.
Absolutely. I know one of the first recommendations or tips that I got when I started in the IT business as a developer was when my boss told me a good programmer is a lazy programmer, which I looked at him quizzically when he told me that, thinking, what are you telling me to be lazy? But what he was telling me to do was look for better ways, look for more efficient ways to let the system do the heavy lifting. Ultimately, we're going to have some responsibility to review those things, but don't do the grunt work. The system can do it much more effectively and efficiently than we can. And PolicyMinder is a great example of that. Be it AIX, Linux, Windows, or IBMI, the expectation is that the server has cycles that it can go out much more quickly and effectively than we can, check the settings of that server, and report back on noncompliance. So the concept here is that we define the desired policy. We indicate how we want our servers to be configured, and then the server can repeatedly, as often as you want, check to see if it is currently adhering to that expectation. If it's not, we're going to flag it. Now, this is great from an exception standpoint. Certainly, if you do this manually, you have to check every setting every time, even if they were all correctly configured. In this case, what we're trying to do is locate that proverbial needle in the haystack. If there is an item that is not correctly configured, we're going to flag it so that you focus your valuable time and attention on those items that are not correct. Now, one of the nicest features of PolicyMinder is the fact that if it does find non-compliant items or discrepancies, that in certain cases we have the ability to correct those, giving the server the ability to self-heal, if you will, from configuration mistakes. Now, some people love that idea. Some people are a little concerned by that idea. I've been around the block long enough to know that sometimes allowing a server to just magically change things back is not always exactly what we want to do. Perhaps change control needs to be involved, or some decisions need to be made as to whether the server configuration is actually what it should be set to, and that the policy needs to be updated. So the ability for us to self-heal is something that we can configure. So for those of you that have the courage and decide that's the direction you want to go, we can absolutely satisfy that, enabling you to maintain consistent configuration without actually any manual intervention. For those of you that perhaps prefer the control of it, you have the ability to determine what is out of compliance, what would change if I were to fix it, and then decide if you wish the automation to do it, or if you wish to investigate and do it yourself. All right. So one of the things that we recommend is that, of course, you document a security policy. As I mentioned earlier, having some type of internal document that gives you the recommendations that you should be adhering to, which are going to be based upon either best practices or a regulation that you have to deal with, it's important to have that baseline of recommendations. If you don't have that, any work that you do to clean up your system is going to be kind of lost over time, because we have a tendency to gravitate towards the easy, and the easy is often the non-secure. And so having that policy gives us something to measure ourselves against. Of course, ultimately, ultimately, I don't want a full-time job in checking settings. So automating the verification of that policy adherence is a huge benefit to the organization, making us more effective so that we can focus human resources on those projects that we actually have to think about. We have to manage personnel-wise. Now, we most likely have multiple servers, maybe perhaps heterogeneous different server platforms, and we have to really manage that. PolicyMinder is really unique in that it can handle Windows, AIX, Linux, and IBM on Power. So the ability for us to look at these services on all these servers through a single pane of glass is going to be a big benefit when it comes to actually managing the environment. We don't have to write scripts for each individual server, although you can extend the functionality of the application through user-defined scripts, but a lot of that functionality is already included in the product. Our goal is either to satisfy a regulatory mandate or simply satisfy best practices, ideally then making us more secure. We want to simplify the task of demonstrating adherence to that standard so that when the auditor does come in, they're not really there to audit our servers. They're there to determine whether we are auditing our servers on an ongoing basis. And if you can show that you have a very effective mechanism for checking the state of the servers on a regular recurring basis, then we're going to probably bode much better in the eyes of the auditor that we're staying on top of our configuration. I mentioned the single pane of glass, the ability to not necessarily care what the server platform is, but to be able to go out and look at that configuration from a single point of view. That's going to, of course, make it much simpler and much more effective way of determining either compliance or non-compliance. Anything that you want to add there, Mike, from your experience working with AIX customers with regards to the goals and aspirations that we should have?
Yeah, Robin, certainly the customers I've been speaking to have lots of machines, and their problem is time. It's not the checking, it's the time. And more often than not, they have these scripts already that they're running on their systems, but they want to bring that into a centralized system. And that's the great thing about PolicyMinder and how it works. If we take a look at this slide here, we can see that we install it onto a console server, which can be a Windows machine, or it can be AIX, or RHEL. On our managed servers, we can cover AIX, Red Hat, Enterprise Linux, Oracle Linux, CentOS, Ubuntu, and Windows. And it's an agentless piece of software. What we do is we create a secure shell connection through a user ID created on those machines, and it's all accessed from the console server. So there's actually nothing at all running. There is no overhead on your managed servers. And we can schedule periodically for the machine to the console server to go out and interrogate those machines and tell us whether we're compliant. And that can all be controlled, configured, and viewed from a browser. And it runs, as you can see, with Chrome on Android, Firefox, Safari, and IE. So you can access PolicyMinder from wherever you choose. How it works is we've got five policy categories. We have user accounts and files, for which we have security checkup templates that are shipped with the software that you can use to deploy immediately, or you can create your own, obviously for your different requirements. We also have, for configuration, exported directories and daemons. We have lists, and we can create a baseline of the configuration, exported directories and daemons on from a single machine. So if you already have a great security policy set up, you can say, okay, we're going to take the policy from machine A, and we'll scan machine A, and that can become your baseline. You can then export that to all your other machines within your network, and you can then check out the differences between all of your systems. And for scripts, well, you can run any script. You may already have a script run that maybe checks that your application is compliant, but you may need to run that every so often. With PolicyMinder, you can simply import it into the console server, and it will run it for you, and it will return within the console whether the script is compliant or not. And looking at it. Here's a single screenshot of the web-based interface. And you can see I don't have too many systems to work on. It's not like I've got a data center full of machines out there. But I can see immediately, here's the thing, in the middle there, the category status, I can see whether my users, my files, configuration, exported directories, daemons or scripts are compliant, non-compliant, or have not yet been checked by a simple red, green or white box. Now I've been using this for a good 12 months now. I find it is really good. It's been really well received by the customers I've deployed it with. How does that look, Robin?
Fantastic. It's certainly a much simpler task to check for a colored box than it is to have to go out to each individual system. And certainly from an IBMI perspective, we have a similar capability there, of course, as well. The settings are different than they are in the AX Web, but the concepts are exactly the same. Enable the system to check more frequently than we are likely to do ourselves. Check the system more comprehensively than we are going to be able to do ourselves. And do so with less effort. Sounds like a win-win to me.
Yeah, absolutely. And the great thing with this is we can automate that, obviously. It can be scheduled, and we can automate the reports that come out of it. So your auditors or your security department can get those reports emailed directly to them from the machine with no human intervention, which satisfies a lot of regulatory mandates.
Absolutely. So really, as we summarize here, of course, you know, anytime you plan to schedule surgery, you're typically going to go see your family doctor first. So we still have the recommendation of determining whether the existing configuration is already compliant with either regulations or best practices. That's best performed through some type of risk assessment. That's an area we can also help with here at health systems and be able to perform that type of evaluation and give you recommendations on whether there should be adjustments made to your existing configuration. Of course, after you find that, then you make the decision of whether you're going to change those configurations or whether you're going to document them as exceptions. And of course, then after you mitigate it, we want to make sure that the time and money and effort that you expended in getting the server set cleanly is not wasted and is lost over time. So implementing those recurring compliance checks using a tool like Policy Finder is the most effective way to keep your servers in a clean state. And as you can see in number four, repeat over and over. So the automation makes that a less mind-bending prospect I would offer for any of us that perhaps don't look to have a full-time job just looking at settings on the server. As I mentioned before, security is a lifestyle. It's not going away. The security risks will continue to grow and evolve. It may not be the same risk tomorrow as it is today. We may not be using the same devices and connection methodologies tomorrow as we are today. But one thing is certain, anytime there is a human on the planet and data on a database or in a database, there's going to be risk of somebody trying to access it without permission. So we want to make sure that we secure our servers, keep them there, and automate that mundane and repeatable process to ensure that the server stays as well configured as it possibly can. All right, I thank you very much for your time in the primary presentation. Matt, Mike, always a pleasure getting your expertise and having you weigh in here and sharing with us your expertise and experience securing AIX servers. And then we'll look forward to seeing you perhaps on the upcoming webinar. Thanks again.
Thank you, Robin. Bueno, con esto vamos a dar por terminado este Webex. Agradecemos de su tiempo y cualquier duda o inquietud sobre esta tecnología o servicios, no duden en llamarnos al teléfono que se encuentra en pantalla o igual escribirnos a nuestro correo electrónico. Hasta pronto y que tengan un excelente día.